This is the CC Radio Podcast.
Welcome to the Countdown Podcast and our review of Candyman. My name is Wayne.
And my name is Paul. Straight into it then for this spiritual sequel, as they're calling it, to the 1992 original.
So this is supposed to be after the Virginia Manson one, right after it? As opposed to all the sequels afterwards?
There's only two others
after
it. So they've eschewed those two and it's following straight on. This one is directed by Nia DaCosta. Mm-hmm. DaCosta. Its screenplay is by Jordan Peele, Wynne Rosenfeld, and Nia DaCosta herself. And it is based on Bernard Rose's Candyman and The Forbidden by Clive Barker. It stars Yahya Abdul-Mateen II, Tiana Paris, Nathan Stewart Jarrett, and Coleman Domingo. It's 91 minutes long. The budget was about $25 million. And thus far in its opening weekend, it's made $9.1 million. Projected to make in the North America's alone $20 million in its opening weekend, Wayne.
That's not bad.
It's going to do very well.
Right.
This is going to be a bona fide hit. What is the film about?
Okay. Okay, so it's present day and it's a decade after the last of the Cabrini Towers, which is this place in where, Paul?
Chicago,
were torn down. Anthony and his partner move into a loft in this now gentrified Cabrini area, and a chance encounter with an old-timer exposes Anthony to the true story behind Candyman, who was some motherfucker who killed motherfuckers back in the day.
Sure.
So now Anthony uses these like macabre type things to make, he's an artist by the way, and he does like art and shit with it, and let's just say shit doesn't go well. How's that?
Yeah, okay, that's fair. According to Rotten Tomatoes, 85% of 217 critics have given this film a positive rating with an average of 7.3 out of 10, and the always harsher Metacritic is only marginally harsher today, 72 out of 100 based on 46 reviews, indicating generally favorable reviews, Wayne.
Are you fucking shitting me?
The look on Wayne's face. It follows perfectly on from his earlier side.
Wait, everyone likes this?
Wayne, what did you think? General impressions only, non-spoilers at this point, of Candyman.
Okay, I'll do it properly. All right. So there are things about this that I could point to that I liked.
Okay, good. Right? Start with those.
All right. So I think that I like the setting of the Chicago art scene.
Chicago way.
The only, because as an art guy myself, I guess I like looking at that shit.
Can I jump in?
Please.
Hated that part of this film. I thought this film, any moment where they got bogged down in talking about the fucking subtleties of art and whatever else, I was like, oh my God, I wish I needed to do a piss.
That's piss funny. Because that's like, I was sitting there going, you know, because it's a bit like that Velvet Buzzsaw.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
So,
but I was hoping to myself, maybe this will be the thing that brings Wayne back.
It is close to the thing that brought me back. And I'll tell you this. I think it's the idea is that they're juxtaposing the disenfranchised black communities, right? Being like this poverty-stricken type area, which is now gentrified. And that's so gentrified that they are now to do with the most unnecessary thing humans can do, which is art. That is the most... I don't mean that pejoratively. I mean like...
Play sport.
No, sport is like makes you fit and shit. Art is completely fucking superfluous, right? And that's why it's the highest calling of you as a human who needs nothing. Yep. Do you know what I mean? In your hierarchy of needs or whatever, that's your self-actualization. Mm-hmm. So that's why I believe they did that. But on the every other way, this is fucking boring, man. This movie's boring.
Oh.
I wasn't fucking scared. I'm a pussy, man. All right? This is like, the original was way better than this. I don't want to actually like... I'm comparing the two.
Yeah, right? Well, of course you have to compare.
It's a sequel,
this is a sequel.
Right? Exactly. Original, like in the original, Virginia Madsen is like fucking, you know, she looks in the mirror, she does the Candyman thing, she passes out, wakes up, blood everywhere, motherfuckers got killed, did she kill? There was intrigue. This is one thing. There's no intrigue here. You know what's up, and that's the whole thing for the whole movie.
Okay.
I found that not particularly interesting. Right. I actually thought you might not like it, Paul. I mean, what the hell? The main characters were, to me, not especially engaging.
100% agree.
Okay. Social commentary, fine.
I'll weigh in here. I think this is a smart update of what we saw in the original. So without giving anything away in this non-spoiler section, I really like the way it embraced the times. And we need to remember this film was shot in 2019, before shit went down last year, if I could put it in that way.
Okay. Okay, so that's
that said, I don't want to make it pretend like 2020 had a monopoly on race relations and tension and all the rest of that shit.
It was always going to be this kind of movie, and I'm fine with that.
But I like that part. I think the way that it updated the Candyman mythos was really smart and really worked. So big ticks in that regard to me. The social commentary, therefore, is fine. Right?
I agree.
I liked
it's fine.
In fact, better than fine. I liked it. I thought that was a good, smart way of doing this. But it seemed to come at the cost of characters that A, behaved in sometimes believable ways,
mm-hmm.
and B, weren't that engaging. So particularly, and I've been on record before, I thought Yahya Abdul-Mateen was terrible in Aquaman. Not that he's bad in this role. I don't think he's a bad actor here.
I don't think it's
But
a
I think
role.
His character is pretty fucking terrible.
Yes, it's written not in... It's
no.
He's an artist, so fine, right?
Well, that's strike one.
I mean, it would be, to be fair though, it's probably hard for a layperson to relate to this dude who's got this like curator girlfriend and he's in this highfalutin yeah. art thing and his big struggle is that he can't quite get the art piece yep. he wants. You know what I mean? That's not fucking sympathetic.
But the problem with him is we don't get much of a sense of him outside of that other than he's got a girlfriend. She happens to be in a position of note in this artistic world.
Yep.
And he's a bit obsessed with A, his work, and then with Candyman.
Right.
Right? That's all you get about him. Nothing else about him stands out. There's nothing to throw in with. There's no...
History.
Yeah. Horror movies are renowned for being short, sharp, and to the point.
Not this one. It's like 2 hours.
This is 91 minutes long.
Bro, I was halfway through, and I looked, and I Googled it. That's how fucking great this movie was, right?
Oh.
I Googled it, and I was like, how runtime for Candyman? 2 hours. And I went,
no,
I'm
no,
here for
you read the wrong thing.
I must have read the first one.
It's 91 minutes.
Well, the first one didn't. This one felt like 2 hours.
Well, that's what I'm saying to you. That's not a good sign at all.
That's not a good sign.
Whereas, so I didn't like him at all because I think we needed an extra 10 minutes about his character, a little bit more about him.
Make me care.
Struggling, about him being a better boyfriend, about, like, we get that one scene between he and his girlfriend's brother and his partner. That's not enough.
No.
It's not enough to make you care about this guy so that when bad shit starts befalling him, it's like, eh, so.
And there's a couple of, well, there's one sequence where like some woman kind of cracks onto him and he kind of goes and he just kind of like flags it off. And I'm like, oh, that's making...
I don't remember that shit.
It was when he went to like a library or something and there was a chick.
Oh,
like,
yes. Yes, I do
girl.
Remember. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and I'm like, oh, okay. So we like him because he's not
a philanderer.
Player. Yeah, exactly. Right. So that's all I got though. That's kind of as deep as we went.
Pretty thin to handle. I agree. And I don't think any of the other... call the main characters are particularly well drawn either. Even Brianna, his girlfriend, is like, eh, okay.
Oh, man, so, she's annoying as shit.
No, she wasn't annoying. She just was, I don't care.
Okay, maybe I didn't care, but like I was like, I don't know.
She wasn't a bad person.
No, but again, very hard to relate to. Here's this woman who's trying to get to New, you know, like yep. to be this curator
again,
in New York.
And particularly for me, who's not in this artistic world, I'm just like, whatever. When they're talking about, oh, your boyfriend and his view of the world, is, I'm like, what the fuck?
Look, I'm a little bit in this world and I don't give a fuck. So, you know.
All right. Now that I've said all that, I'm going to have to weigh in now with what is amazing about this
movie. Oh, my God. You love it.
I don't love it. I don't love it.
Like it a lot.
I like it. I think this one is good.
Really?
If you're a Candyman fan, if you're a horror film fan, you absolutely have to go and see it.
Sweet.
And you should see
crap.
It on the big screen.
I did.
Because it is beautiful, this film. It is so well composed and shot and put together. The soundtrack is phenomenal. The sound design is incredible. The practical effects, off the chain.
Huh?
Some of the gore in this film is to die for. It's so well put together.
Really?
Very, very rarely is it obvious CG blood. So all the technical aspects really work. The film opens with reversed credit. Like,
yes.
So
noticed
clever.
That immediately. I was like, ooh, ooh. Mirror. Ooh.
Because I'm like,
Did they fuck up?
Then I had to go, hang on, it's a digital print.
Exactly, they can't roll it backwards
no,
and play it. Exactly.
Doesn't work that way. So I'm like, oh, this is deliberate, that's cool.
I really like that part.
Nia DaCosta's view, I love some of the shots.
The upward shots upside down from the buildings?
Beautiful.
Gotta say, that was beautiful. And that's one of the other things I like about this film. It is shot very
well.
Yeah,
so that's what I'm saying. It's a beautiful film.
Usually that gets me over the line, bro.
And the fact, I thought this is what might have got you there. I knew you weren't even a big score, but I thought if we can eke out a 50 or a 53 from you, then I'd be happy. But it eschews. It doesn't worry about jump scares. This is all about atmosphere and ominous building of dread. And I think this film does that well in a lot of sequences. I think it fumbles the ball towards the end a bit, but there are some absolute sequences here where it kind of builds and builds and builds. And I'm like, Hot damn. That was nice and very well put together.
Really?
It's, that's what I thought as a horror film fan on this.
You know,
podcast.
This is. I mean, look. Let's sort of temper my cool review of this with the fact that these are not my pictures. Like,
yeah,
these
absolutely. Are not, you know, we know. Look, anyone who listens to the show, and if you're new to the show, welcome. It's great to have you here. Yeah. But if you are a listener to the show, you know that Wayne probably was not.
I was never
likely to like this film.
Yeah, I hardly ever. And there's actually a moment in my head when I'm looking at these movies, going, okay, you know what? This is not your film. So what are you going to do to be productive about this review? How are you going to actually
leave it
make
to Paul.
This? Yeah, that's definitely rule one. And the second rule is no, so take from it what you can. And so the best thing about the film, I thought, was that the idea that there's this guy, and this is just me, but like the Yaya dude, he's like an artist, he's stuck.
Anthony, his name is. Yeah.
Anthony, yeah, right? So he's stuck or whatever, so he goes, I want to do something about a project or whatever, you know, these places that were, you know, disenfranchised youth or whatever. So he just goes out that day, and just starts poking around the neighborhood, and he's hiding from the police, and he finds a guy, and he starts talking, and then he sits through his laundromat. And he's actually just sitting there building this world that he's going to create his art from. And it's really interesting to me. They go, oh my God, there are people who just do that. Like, they think their whole day is
inspirational,
I'm gonna find out about.
Maybe, Wayne?
Very inspirational, all right? And still I was bored.
Demented and sad, but social.
Yeah, so, look, you know.
I get it. I'm not surprised. I'm not even disappointed. Not after watching Essendon get flogged today in a elimination final. Nothing will compare.
Yeah, everyone pulls a little upset because his team is
so if I seem flat after 6,200 and I think it's 5 days or 3 days, whatever it is, that's why. But look, I enjoyed my time at cinema. I was pleased I went there. It's not a fantastic film, but in a very sparse year, and I know I say this every year in August, September, every fucking year, this year is not a good year for movies. I don't think last year was a terrible year for film. I think this is slightly better overall, but we're a long way from the heights of the mid-2010s. A long, long way.
Sure.
And I know that's COVID affected, but in an otherwise pretty average year, I guess what I'm trying to say is this is a good film. And if you're at all interested in the things I've said, then you should see it. I think maybe we should just get into spoilers.
Yeah,
get
spoilers because I got some questions too.
Because I do have some things I really want to shit on.
Okay.
In terms of the lore of this world.
All right, let's do that.
All right, come on, Jack. Let us in.
You can't handle the truth.
And the truth is that there are some dubious changes to the lore of the Candyman from this film to the first.
Good. Let's get into him because I've got a ton of questions.
Big pro. One. So the first is, so I can't remember his name, but Tony Todd's character was murdered for impregnating a white woman back in whatever it was, the 1890s from vague memory.
Righto.
And it becomes his vengeful force. And in the first film, he kills everybody who says his name five times.
Right.
White, black, any other minority that you can think of, he kills them all.
Right.
This film, not one single minority character dies.
Really?
There's even a great moment, it's a great moment in an otherwise superfluously stupid scene where we see early in the film at his art opening gallery, not just his, he's got one little bit, one installation, whatever they call it, versus a whole bunch of other artists. And there's this young teenage white girl who's looking for a long time. The camera lingers on her. Yes. She walks out of shot. Half an hour later in the film, maybe 40 minutes later in the film, comes back to her in one scene and one scene only, where she's in the bathroom at high school and gets her three mates in and says, let's say the name Candyman five times. They go, Candyman, Candyman, Candyman. After three, the Asian girl goes, fuck this shit, and walks out.
Yeah, I saw that. I remember that. I didn't realize she was a minority.
Yep. And then they kill the other three.
So all the white people die.
Basically.
Really?
Yep. I don't have a problem with that, except against the fact that the first film had a different set of rules. And this one builds on it, like I said, nicely.
I didn't even think about that, man. I didn't notice that. It's amazing.
This one builds on it nicely to go, Candyman's not one person. It's not Tony Todd's character. Candyman is anyone who's been brutally murdered by the predominant culture, by the police force of the predominant culture. And their angst, their outcry echoes through the ages, which I think is really smart in our modern time.
Is that what that meant?
Yes.
I was going to say to you, hey, Polly, why is Tony Todd at the fucking end? What's going on there?
He started it.
But then
somehow we've had three, four, they mentioned, building up to the guy who dies at the, well, in the flashback sequences to be the laundromat owner's Candyman.
Right.
And the guy that does haunt Anthony's sort of dreams.
Yes.
And then Anthony himself becomes the newest iteration of Candyman.
So wait, why did the laundromat owner right?
Very good question.
Why is he trying to make this dude another Candyman? What is that?
Then we get one flashback to where his sister gets killed by Candyman, right?
Yes.
Right. And apparently that makes him a disciple. Did not buy that at all. I think that's also a huge leap in the film, which it doesn't bother to explain. And it's a weak part of the film.
Yeah.
Goes from being a guy who's an authority on it because his sister died to being an active disciple / acolyte thereof. That kind of shits me.
Yeah.
I don't think that works.
No, that makes sense. And did the guy, the laundromat owner, did he die?
Yes.
Okay, so one black guy died.
Yeah, but not by Ken. How did he die? Hang on, we're in the.
He was the instigator. Like, he was the guy putting the fucking hook in his arm.
Actually, you're right. Like he kind of sacrificed himself to bring back. To make Anthony into it.
I think Anthony killed him.
Yeah, save his girlfriend.
Something like that. Yes, that's right.
That's not quite the same thing.
No, it's not, because he wasn't innocent.
He wasn't dead yet. He wasn't the spiritual embodiment of Candyman.
Yeah.
A couple other things.
Go on.
Wayne.
Yes.
If you got stung by a bee, or indeed bitten by any insect / creature.
Oh, God, please tell me about this.
It goes from anything more than a raised red dot with skin that's drying on the outside. How fast would you race to the fucking doctor?
Dude, I've got a note here that I made in the movie saying, this motherfucker is taking forever for his manky-ass, shit-looking hand to go to the doctor. He takes it there when his arm is fucked. I'm like, yo.
I have to be honest. I have to agree with you here, Wayne.
Yeah. This is the dumbest shit anyone ever said in the history of, and I don't think I'm exaggerating here, time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it is literally ridiculous. And I guess they're trying to play it off because he's the child, the baby who's kidnapped in the first one.
I actually didn't see that coming, to be fair. I know everyone else did, but I was like, oh, that's a development.
Yeah.
So, you know, I didn't see that coming.
Vanessa Williams is his mom, reprising her role from the first one.
Oh, is she it?
Yeah.
Bugger me. Didn't see
but, that. Like, if your son, who has been at the center of these Candyman killings, moves back into the area, would you not have a stronger word to say against that?
Absolutely. And also, I don't know, man. Like, the idea, here's my real issue. Right? At the end, right? So all the cops go in or whatever and shoot
the
dude, right?
He's laying on the floor on her lap.
Well, the idea there is that the cops are brutalists, yes? Is that the idea? Because then they came out.
Yes, and let's be honest, some of them are.
Because that's the way the story goes, as in you have to be killed by the oppression of the era.
By the oppression of the predominant culture, privileged culture.
That's what allows you to be a Candyman. So they had to shoot
him. In an unfair and unjust way.
Right.
So not like he did anything wrong.
Yeah. Which is weird to me that they bang, and you see him out of frame.
Why? What was he doing? Okay, he had a hook in his hand stuck in there, but he's laying down.
Well, it was less that than the other thing where they put her in the car and then the cop comes in to work on her and say, hey, so here's the story.
Well, to be honest, that really seems to fit with the modern day. I'm not having a go at police officers in general, but I'm saying that there is clearly this element that exists.
Yeah, right? And you know what? So, and fine, if that, again, social commentary, just I don't really care for it. But like, that being the case, right? The idea behind that scene was that he comes in to try and work on her to tell you, the viewer, we're corrupt, all right? We do shit like that already. Then she decides. But that's the thing that makes her decide to go.
They beat the guy to death earlier in the film in the '70s or whatever it was.
Right, so it's all cops through time. Do you know what I mean?
Then we get they walk in and just shoot him outright. Like, whoa, okay, yes. There's been the guy, the laundromat owner. I can't remember his name.
Yeah,
jumps on the phone and says, "There's a guy here and he's murdering people with a hook in his hand." They walk in. If they see the guy with a hook in his hand lying on his back, no one's shooting that bloke.
Could you make this argument? There's a girl, the guy's on her.
No. Other way around.
No, he's in her lap.
Yeah.
So he's still got a hook there that he could. I don't know.
But then we shouldn't have seen it out of shot.
Yeah, that's what I mean. They should have been. I don't know what that was.
We need to see it framed in a way where it looked like he was threatening.
Yeah, but here's the problem, Paul. So that's the trigger when the cop tries to work on her and she decides to say Candyman 5 times and bring him back because she knew the rule is that he can come back and kill all them motherfuckers. But she's the one who said Candyman, so she should be getting killed too.
Well, that's my point. In this film, Candyman has a choice about who he kills.
At the very, very end.
Well, no.
Or did he do it before?
No. Go back early in the film. And I agree with you. I don't like this because, again, in the first film, he'll kill anyone.
Yeah.
In this film, he only chooses to kill white people.
Yeah.
And I think that's okay as a development, but we need a better explanation.
You need to set the rule. Exactly. Yeah. Why is it different to last time?
Earlier in the film, the very first kill, arguably the best kill of the film, is the gallery owner and his girlfriend. The girlfriend is the one that says it.
Yeah.
Gets her throat slashed open. Really impressive kill. But then the guy doesn't say it.
He didn't say it and he got killed as well.
He got killed too. I'm like, hang on. So now therefore, there are no rules.
Yes.
Why can't Candyman just then kill everyone? If someone summons him, just kill anyone in the proximity? How far does that proximity go?
Right, which he would have done with that girl there as well. So
yeah, I don't think the rules are very well defined.
So that's why it was shit, man. Like,
it's not shit. Not shit. I think the good outweighs the bad here, but I 100% agree with you. It doesn't work overall. And I think people who are giving this an absolute like 4 or 5 star film are overlooking these.
Absolutely. And I'm surprised.
Or they're seeing something I've missed. They've got a line of dialogue
in
there.
Definitely seen something I've missed. Because I'm actually amazed at that. I didn't look at the scores or whatever, but I thought everyone would shit on this.
No. Well, as you just heard.
Yeah, everyone's fucking digging it. I'm amazed.
And I did like seeing Tony Todd at the end and sort of bringing it back around in that particular way. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, I thought the
slaughter of the cops was cool as well.
Yeah, that looked cool and stuff.
Obviously, clearly, fucking deserved it. So
yeah, well, yeah, okay. I mean, yeah, I just didn't dig it at all. So
yeah,
and so anyway, I think, you know what? I thought Jordan Peele was going Anton Fuqua on me. I thought he was just gonna only.
You
do
don't like film. Us either.
No, so I thought he just did Get Out and that was amazing, and the other things have just fallen short. Now, and I thought this was just another one of those. Not that he directed this.
No,
he was only
he
a producer.
He wrote it.
And producer,
co-wrote
it. So, yeah, anyway, hey, whatever.
Well, here's what I think. Overall, then, impressions. I think this film, its style is amazing. I think it oozes atmosphere. I think the technical aspects of the film are wonderful. This is a sophomore director coming into the first horror film, and I think overall she's done a good job. Yes, the plot doesn't quite hold together. I think the characterizations are poor. You don't really care enough about them. I'm surprised by the number of major characters that lived, and they tried to supplement that by just having a whole bunch of cops killed at the end. And a bunch of random white girls killed in the middle of a bathroom, which had no bearing on the plot whatsoever. So overall, I'm giving this the softest 3.5 I can give, 66. I upped it from 63 as I walked out of the cinema because it did stick with me a little bit.
Okay. I think the cool thing that I noticed about this film was once you say the fifth Candyman, you subtly see his reflection in like a brushed aluminium kind of like thing in the bathroom. You can only just make out his coat in the reflection. Mm-hmm. And same with like in the windows and stuff.
So it's very artfully shot. There's that great pull away shot where the art critic gets killed.
Yeah.
And she gets dragged across the
path. That was like hard. Jesus, right? Yeah, I know. Yeah, look, because of its good shooting, that's the best thing for me about it. So it just gets a 41.
Oh, 41. So low!
Bro, it was 34 when I walked out of that thing.
Well, all of your arguments are like
you got
asshole,
me to 41, bro. Oh,
maybe I should be pleased with myself getting a whole extra 7.
I mean it, man.
Otherwise.
Eat my ass! Eat all the S's, man.
By the way, if you're new to this show and you don't understand what the fuck Paul is doing because he doesn't understand comedy, he's playing audio of me saying shit to myself back at me. And, you know, that's
or
confusing.
If you prefer.
That's just fuck off.
No.
Whoa. Eat my balls, motherfucker.
41.
41, man. Yeah, that's... I thought this was a piece of shit, eh? When I walked out, I was like, yo, that was like, it had some good shit,
You're mocking me, aren't you?
Everyone's going to hate this one. Paul's surely going to hate this one. I think I heard Justin fucking Horror Boy Esquivel. From Epic Phil Guys. He kind of shat on it, too.
He thought the social commentary was too heavy-handed.
It's always too heavy-handed, right? But yeah,
check out, not that their review's out yet, but if and when it is, do have a listen there as well. But look, overall, sadly, in a poor year, this is in the top 10 horror films for me.
Sad as fuck.
It's pretty close to my top 10 films of the year. Oh,
this is so good.
Not going to get there.
You reckon?
Yeah. 66, even by my lofty standards, that's a rough year. What did you think of Candyman? What did you think of horror in general in 2021? You can let us know via email thecountdownpodcast@gmail.com, on Twitter @thecountdownpc. Like and follow the show through Podbean, where we host. Check out ccradio.com.au for Comic Confidential and Believe, the other great shows as part of the network, and the Facebook community links in the show notes, where I'm sure we'll get into the conversation about this film in due course. Thanks so much for joining us today. My name is Paul.
My name is Wayne.
And this has been The Soundboard.
Suck my dick.
Wayne. We'll catch you next time. Who can take a sunrise?
Candyman. The Candyman.
Ooh, the Candyman can.